From across the globe, they come with jets. They come to fight. They come to train. They are the best fighter pilots in the world. Exercise Maple Flag wreaks havoc over the vast, unrestricted skies of northern Canada, where an all-out war game is about to kick off. Jets on. Welcome to Cold Lake, recreational paradise, urban amenities, rural warmth. Some come for the beach, some for the small town tranquility. Others come to break the sound barrier. That's right, it's spring, and it's time for Exercise Maple Flag, a massive war game held in the skies above northern Alberta. Since 1978, this four-week multi-nation exercise has brought the best fighter pilots in the world together to fly, fight, and train. Training that is vital to their very survival.
How Maple Flag started was in combat in Vietnam. The combat losses were extremely high for what they wanted, and after many studies, they found out that most of the combat losses were in a wingman's first 10 flights in theater. If he made it through his first 10 flights, he'd probably make it through the rest of the war or the rest of his tour there. Because of that, Red Flag evolved in the States. And 2 years after they started in the States, we started one up here.
In the 80s, it was two exercises per year. In the 90s, it went down to one per year. And it's constantly been an international exercise where we have been able to train the junior combat ready wingman and give him essentially his first 10 combat missions in a simulated environment. This then increases his probability of survivability in a real coalition conflict.
If you actually talk to some of the people that were fighting in Kosovo in the war, they came back and they said a lot of those missions they did felt just like Maple Flag. So the training value for this exercise is very important, I think, and it's very good for us to get that exposure to realize kind of the realities of fighting in a coalition type force, and we really take a lot out of it.
What makes it so real, so valuable to these fighters, is that Maple Flag is held on one of the finest air operations training ranges in the world. The Cold Lake Air Weapons Range covers 1.17 million hectares, has over 640 targets, and is Canada's only tactical bombing range.
The unique thing about it is Cold Lake itself is only about 20 to 30 miles away from the range, so access by aircraft is just a matter of minutes by jet aircraft.
Cold Lake has probably some of the best airspace in the world when it comes to flying fighters. It's completely unrestricted. It's spans about the size of Western Europe, actually. So it's a real nice treat for European fighter pilots to come out here and have this flexibility and ability to really fly the jet where they want to. Supersonic, you know, chaff, flare. You can put 100 aircraft up there and with room to flex. So I think this airspace is very unique, and it allows a lot of people from other countries the ability to really perform with their aircraft in large formations, something that they're probably not used to back home.
Northern Alberta, very large, empty space. We have a range where we can fly supersonic down to 100 feet. We have the airspace up as high as any of our aircraft can possibly fly. We have an enormous amount of volume to put mock-up targets that people can actually go ahead and drop ordnance on. It's just a fantastic flying area.
We have a lot of oil development out on our range, so one thing that we have to offer, which is nice, is real-world target sets as far as, now these are obviously targets that we don't drop on, but an oil upgrader or an oil refiner, an oil platform. So now from a pilot standpoint, where we get involved in weaponeering, it's target sets that I might really be paired against in the real world. So, hey, I want to go and look and learn how I would attack this thing and learn, do the buccaneering behind it and see it for real once. And we also have an extensive number of simulated targets out there, airfields, surface-to-air missile sites, tank berms, convoys. We spend a lot of time developing targets that are as real and current as we can make them.
Making this war game real is the whole idea. And just like any real conflict, each day brings new developments, new missions, and a multitude of possible wartime scenarios.
Captain Paul Emmerich, Squish, Senior Mission Monitor, Maple Flag Staff, Cold Lake, Alberta. As Senior Mission Monitor, my role here is essentially scenario development is a huge part of my role.
Welcome to day one of Maple Flag, day two of the conflict.
In the scenario development, it starts out with a conflict, and essentially, simplistically, bad guys in the west, good guys are in the east, just for how our range is set up, with sort of, you know, neutral countries north and south. So as it starts out initially, is there's been some skirmishes over oil and resources, and you know, typical things where they've kind of gone across into the eastern country looking for their resources, and NATO resolutions are drafted. Eventually, skirmishes start to happen. Air power is brought in, and this is when sort of it becomes a coalition effort. So initially it'll be just minor strikes across the political border, if you will, into the west to just kind of show that the coalition means business. But as it progresses, it starts escalating into full-on warfare. So we'll go deeper and deeper to the west as the war progresses, trying to hit all the military-type targets that you would be looking for and try and keep it as close to a real progression as possible. However, what we're doing is giving, you know, 3 years of war in 10 days, also showing all the worst possible scenarios they could witness so that they have some training in it.
Sounds like a solid game plan. Adhere to the brief game plan. It's your first mission for the Maple Flag launch. The purpose of this mission is to give you a range for mil. That is the overriding factor. We want you to get the air-to-air training and the surface threat training today as well. We're pushing you deep into the western part of the range so you can see the entire range. Realize that being said, you do have a robust air threat out there today. You are fighting the Adder. We don't train against the Adder much, so think about what that means to you. And that's all I have for comments. Have a good war, gentlemen.
You get to sit and try and visualize the way ahead for warfare and where you think it's going. And you also have a lot of leeway to make some fairly interesting scenarios. My satisfaction comes when I put in a new scenario and I get feedback from everyone that, you know, wow, that was fun, or that was a great scenario. Conversely, I also get a lot of feedback if they don't like the scenarios, so you always get the good with the bad.
For the past 30 years, the Air Force Tactical Training Center at Four Wing Cold Lake has hosted Maple Flag, bringing together international air crews, every tactical airframe imaginable, all with an eye towards training. Training for the new era that is coalition warfare. A typical day at Maple Flag begins long before the 6:30 a.m. mass brief and ends well after the 5:30 p.m. debrief. In between, two daily missions play out over 10 days. Each day intensifies as the war escalates.
It is meant to be intense. It's meant to be a very busy day. It's meant to be a heavy workload to keep that combat simulation. We can't put them under true combat stress, but we can keep busy days where you have to work hard, you have to work under stress so that you learn how other countries handle stress.
During mission planning, they're busy. They're working, they're running, gathering information, changing plans. It's a constantly evolving planning process. And the guys doing that planning are running around with their hair on fire, barely having time to grab a cup of coffee. The briefings, they're very thorough, very in-depth, and that's where the guy kind of sits back and he's got to absorb all that planning and concentrate. And then he's got about an hour break there where they stop, get dressed, get ready to go. You're getting ready to go flying, and you have that time to think as you're getting airplanes started and really think about, hey, I'm going to take off here. Maybe my first mission ever that there might be 60 or 70 aircraft airborne in. And I think that really starts to get the blood flowing. And then as you start to see the other formations of taxi across in front of you and you realize that you're part of something this big, it's almost wartime. Not quite, but it's close. Your heart's pumping. You get to your target and the first time, you're like, I can't screw this up. I got to find my lead off target. I got to get my bombs on target. And it can be pretty intense for a brand new guy when you're all that excitement's going on.
As a junior wingy, they're not expecting a whole heck of a lot. They're expecting me to stay visual and put my bombs on target. I can definitely notice a trend being more comfortable, and my capacity is going up day to day. So it's kind of neat to see from my perspective that in a 2-week period, you can actually make that kind of improvement.
And then the race home afterwards, you know, it's like, hey, I've dropped my bombs. Just get me home, right? You get the throttles up as high as you can go with the fuel you've got, as fast as you can go back to good guy land. You come down, land, and you think, okay, it's over, but it's not. Now it's the debrief. So you know, you're into your debrief, reviewing your tapes. There's not really enough time to do everything. So you're trying to find out when you shot who, where you dropped your bombs, were they a hit, were they not? Get all that information to your lead so you can all go to your debrief and run through everything. And that whole process is about a 12-hour process almost. And what a use of adrenaline while you're flying. When you're done, you are wiped. You've had a long, long working day with a lot of adrenaline through your body, and it is tiring. And by Friday, you're glad it's the weekend.
Good thing is when you have the good trips, like, it feels awesome. And I guess pretty incredible. You start to discover what you are. It tests your limits every day, that's for sure. You have to be confident because, I mean, you are humbled on a daily basis.
Being a fighter pilot is in their blood, rookie and expert alike. What they love about it may differ, but none would trade it for the world.
You know, I don't really think there's any other way to say it, but it was in my blood. As long as I can remember, ever since I was 4 years old, it's all I wanted to do. And I do remember the distinct moment. My father took me to an air show, and I remember seeing a fighter jet doing a display, and I told my dad, that's what I'm gonna do. And he humored me, and you know, a couple years later, it never changed. Like, well, you know, what about policeman or fireman or anything else? It never wavered, it never changed. It's all I wanted to be. And I consider myself very lucky to be standing here having had it work out, because I really didn't have much else in the way of backup plans, but it was just always there for me. I had a very strong calling. You'll find, I think, talking to most fighter pilots, a lot of them will say the same thing. It's almost a calling.
The thrill of it, it's continuously changing environment. There's continuous challenges. You work and fly with some of the best and most dedicated people you'll find anywhere in the world, in my opinion. And that just makes it an exciting job. It's hard to even call it a job. I can't believe they actually pay me to do this. And it really is a continuous thrill every day.
Every once in a while you get a mission where there's like 5 or 10 minutes that you've got to just sit back and relax as you're transiting home or transiting out to the airspace. And you look out the window, and the airplane's got a leading edge extension. You look over and you lean over the Lex and you go, wow, I'm getting paid to do this, right? Who's the luckiest guy in the world? I wish you could get a chance to feel that feeling more often, but no, it's pretty exciting, pretty awesome job.
It's the single greatest job in the universe. You're flying one of these, it's a lot of hard work, it's a lot of constant, you know, you are studying. You have to work for the fun that you get, but the payoff gets every time you take that in the air. And I mean, you're flying the fastest machine in the nation. You have a great view from the office. It's you get to blow stuff up. I mean, to me, it's everything I ever thought it could be.
At Maple Flag, flying a jet for the friendly forces known as Blue Air is what it's all about for these pilots. But in this war game, not everyone is friendly. The enemy forces have also come to play. Elite professional aggressors. They are Red Air.
Direction 46,000.
Speed trail group friend 0018, 45,000 hostiles. 53,000 hostiles.
Sniff. Exercise Maple Flag is designed to slowly escalate the threat levels of war. Day by day, the missions become more difficult, more challenging, more threatening. It's done with a purpose. In real war, there's a lot to worry about. Anti-aircraft guns, targeting, collateral damage, anti-aircraft missiles, enemy aircraft. It's a lot for the pilots to learn, but it's critical if they're to survive their first 10 combat missions. In air combat, there are no second chances. At Maple Flag, Red Air are the bad guys. Full-time professional adversary forces. They are some of the best fighter pilots in the world. They are the U.S. 64th Aggressor Squadron from Nellis Air Force Base and Canada's Top Aces.
Top Aces, we're a civilian company and built around a recently retired CF-18 pilot with a lot of experience. And we've been participating in Maple Flag for 3 years now, so this is our third year. And what we do is we're an integrated aggressor force with the U.S. aggressor, and we provide red air here in Maple Flag. So we fly the Alpha jets to replicate, you know, certain types of aggressor aircraft, and tactics to provide training to the Canadian CF-18s that are here, and also all the other NATO forces.
The integrated red air forces look and act like the enemy. They paint their jets in camouflage, convene top secret briefings, and fight to win.
We tend to hire more experienced aviators so that they have seen, you know, they've had operational tours and understand what the blue side does. And then we study the threat so that we know what's out there as best we can. We try to replicate that threat as well as teach the threat.
What we're going to be doing today is we're playing red air. So basically what our job is, we're trying to train the blue forces in some kind of large package environment. So for example, they're going to try and ingress from the east to west to hit targets. And our job is to replicate whatever nation they ask us to replicate, its adversaries. So we'll go out there and work with the aggressors. And we're going to fly certain profiles, certain weapon envelopes. And we see how the blue air guys do against us.
We're not about assessing how we do. We always try to do better at providing good training for blue, but we tend to look at blue's performance against us, and they've done spectacular this period.
Red air plays a huge role in the Maple Flag learning process. They give their 2 cents at the blue air mass briefs, leaving halfway through to devise their own tactics and allow blue air to do the same. They attend every debrief to assist in analyzing the lessons learned on the daily missions. Best of all, they have a fighter pilot's dream job.
I've always loved to be a fighter pilot, and all our pilots are the same. It's the true diehard fighter pilots that are here. So an exercise like Maple Flag is really the summum of training for fighter pilots on both sides, blue air or red air. So this is really fun. And for me as the president, I don't get to participate in all the exercise, but I definitely make a point to come to Maple Flag because that's, you know, definitely the top exercise for the year. I love it.
It's been great. This is what the aggressors really bring to the fight. It's going out there and executing some realistic tactics, providing good replication for the opposing forces.
So which side usually wins at Maple Flag? The good guys flying blue air or the bad guys flying red air?
There may be some jest and some fun, but no, we're here strictly to provide good training for the coalition forces. It's not about a good day for us is if we're unable to target any of the blue forces and we all die, then we go home and we sleep good at night knowing our guys know how to get it right.
In a simulated war game like Maple Flag, with none of the bullets real and no one actually getting shot down, the only way to know who won in the end is with some very high-tech eyes in the sky.
The evolution of Maple Flag and mission planning itself has gone from the basic acetate slide and the whiteboard into currently we have the portable flight planning system, and that allows us to take a look at the aircraft in real time prior to the mission in order to achieve the planning, along with that various presentation software.
Before each mission, the planes are programmed into a computer-generated version of the mission flow. The pilots get to see what they're about to do up on the big screen at the mass brief. Before takeoff, each jet is loaded with a GPS pod that sends images back to Cold Lakes Air Force Tactical Training Center.
The ACMI pods, they take the information via microwave and send it back to AFTTC, the Air Force Tactical Training Center, to be displayed on the screen. And that provides us with the continuity of learning that the participants require throughout the exercise. So very similar from the pre-mission, the planning, to the demonstration of that, all the way through to post-mission debriefing.
With today's theater of operations, there's so much going on in the air and on the ground, it can get tainted and mixed very quickly. It's very important that the forces in the air know where the friendly forces on the ground are and therefore not engage. So the advancements that we're making at Maple Flag, technology-wise and with our training systems, are enabling that type of learning.
Without this technology, Exercise Maple Flag would be very tough to pull off. But for the Canadian pilots stepping to the flight line, it's the high-tech bird known as the F-18 Hornet where the real magic happens. The F-18 Hornet. Multi-role tactical fighter jet. Supersonic turbo-powered aircraft. When it fires up, its twin engines shake the earth.
The F-18 is probably one of the best fighter jets in the world. It's a multi-role capability, so we can fight air-to-air, we can dogfight and shoot missiles beyond visual range as we fight our way into the target with bombs on. So self-escort strike, we try to do it all, and we do train to do it all.
With 60 to 100 jets in the air at one time, there's both risk and reward for the flyers who play the game called Maple Flag.
It's true the stakes are high here. There is a risk involved with Maple Flag. There's a risk anytime with fighters. I mean, that risk we've all accepted and made our peace with. And that is not that we are all adrenaline junkies, but that is part of what makes the job worthwhile, is you get to, you know, fly something that not everyone can fly.
There's not a flight in any airplane, really, and specifically in a fighter, that you can't take something away from it.
Only a fool thinks they have their tactics all figured out. You can learn from everybody. You can discount what you don't like and certainly hoist on board what you like.
All of it is a perishable skill. You know, if you're not doing it all the time for a while, it takes a little bit to catch back up to the plane again. It travels pretty fast. It sometimes will leave us behind.
The future is about making Maple Flag viable for the participants. They need to be able to operate in a coalition environment that exists today or tomorrow, and we need to enable that training here at Maple Flag.